Welcome to 12 News Valley Dish, folks, and happy Tuesday. Give us 30 minutes and we will give you a great dinner idea. We've also got a dog that has dozens of outfits and a great kid reporter who goes to the zoo. I'm your host, Tram I, and we want to welcome Chef Laura Slama to the show today for the very first time. It's great to have you.
Great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Okay, we are later on going to make these sweet potato fries, and I cannot believe that they are baked.
And they're so good.
I cannot wait for that because usually I think, uh-oh, fried food, but you know what?
It's going to be a lot of fried personally, so
yes, no, I like that.
Baked is good.
So do my thighs. All right, check out Laura's recipe on our website, valleydish.azcentral.com. Now let's check out what ingredients you're going to need for today's cod, fish sticks, and chipotle tartar sauce. 2 large eggs, 1/3 cup of milk, 1 cup of panko, 1 cup of flour, 1 pound of cod fillets, 8 tablespoons of olive oil, and some salt and pepper. Now for the tartar sauce, you're going to need 1 cup of mayonnaise, 2 teaspoons of chipotle puree, 1 tablespoon of onion, 4 tablespoons of chopped dill pickle, 2 teaspoons of lemon juice, and a pinch of pepper, and that's it. I was amazed to see that you're really not asking for a lot of ingredients for this.
No, you don't need a lot of ingredients to make food taste great.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's do it.
All right, let's do this. So first things first, we have our 3-step breading procedure set up for our fish. So a couple things. One, we're going to crack our eggs right into here. And if you want to grab the milk right here, you'll notice it's in a liquid measuring cup. So you always want to be sure you're measuring your liquid in a volume measuring cup. It does make a difference.
And did you use non-fat, low-fat? What'd you use?
You can use any kind of milk you want to. I used whole milk for today, but you're going to get a very similar result no matter what. And if you're trying to cut calories and trying to cut fat, then by all means, use a non-fat, or a 2% milk.
And it's so fun.
Yep, it's all good. So we have just regular all-purpose flour right here. And this is panko. And panko is a Japanese-style breadcrumb. And I love using these because they're coarser. And as a result, they will absorb some of the liquid, some of the moisture, but they'll stay crispy on the coating, and kids like a crunch when they eat.
Yes.
And if you think about it, so do we as adults, because we eat as much for texture as we do for flavor.
I prefer the panko too, but if folks at home don't have the panko and they have just regular breadcrumbs,
that's
can they
fine.
Use that too?
Absolutely.
Okay, perfect.
Absolutely. So that all works. So now, here's the thing. Mm-hmm. Here's our Alaskan cod, and if you wanted to use something like halibut, you could as well. It doesn't matter, but a lean white fish is really what you want to use, especially because this is mild in flavor, and so kids are going to be more inclined to enjoy eating it as well. Okay? Plus, adults will love it because it's already low in fat.
Right.
All right, so what you want to do, though, is we're going to dredge this first in a little bit of flour. Mm-hmm. Now, I picked it up with my left hand, so now this is my wet hand.
Okay,
left hand is wet.
Hand.
See how they kind of rhyme?
Yes.
Okay, so what you'll do then is you'll drop that into the flour, and you're going to sprinkle it with now your right hand, which is the dry hand, which picks it up. So now your right hand is dry, your left hand is wet.
Right.
And you always want to shake off some of that excess flour, otherwise it'll get gummy when you go to make this.
Okay? Oh, yeah. And then you have really messy hands.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Now, I put it into my egg mixture here, so I'm going to go ahead and just coat that with a little bit of the egg mixture. And now, with my wet hand again, I'm going to drop it into my panko, take my dry hand, sprinkle it with the breadcrumbs so they stick.
Okay.
Okay, and then I'll be getting ready to cook these off. So to do that, get my pan over here, and notice I put my saute pan on the stove empty, okay? I want to heat up the pan first before I add the oil to it.
Right.
And this way, when I do add my oil, it will just heat right up. So this can sit in the panko as long as we want it to. I see how you're doing
very well with that
left hand.
Laura, I am seriously concentrating on this whole left hand, or wet hand, dry hand art.
Well, because think about the alternative. You'll look like a mutant if you don't.
Well, you know what? I've been looking like a mutant every single time I do, you know, any dredging. And so
but
this
it's
is,
working for you.
I have to think about this. I'm you know, really concentrating here. So there we go. So I'm glad I don't have, you know, flour sticky hands.
Right,
like
exactly. So you just have one left, right, left. So just think about that. So now you could actually do several pieces at one time. And
all right.
This is going to go right in the oil. Uh-huh. We know our oil's ready because we can actually hear a little bit of a sizzle.
And it's really not, you're not really deep frying it, which is what I love.
No, we're just doing a pan fry and that's it. And we'll go right from our pan then onto our paper towels to get our liquid absorbed a little bit. Okay.
So. I'm thinking again,
yep,
I'm thinking this
left is
my
wet. Left is wet.
Okay.
And you can actually do a few pieces.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
See, now you're getting, sassy
then,
with it.
Now I can be like Mel Messina and just, you know, rip through this whole segment and do, you know, fast cooking. So, all right. So I'm going to do that.
Okay. So what's pretty cool, too, is because you're doing a 3-step procedure, you're not just dredging it in flour and then holding it.
Mm-hmm.
You never, if any time a recipe says, you know, just put it in flour and then put it right into the pan, you want to put it in the flour and then right into the pan right away. You never want to let it sit.
Let it sit.
Because then it does get super gummy, and that's really kind of gross. But if you are coating it with panko, then you could actually, if you wanted to, do this, put it on a sheet tray and stick it in your refrigerator, and let it just chill until you're ready to cook it. So you could do it in the morning when you're getting the kids ready for school, and then cook it off later when everybody's getting ready for dinner.
Okay, that's a great idea. You were saying this could work well with even chicken. If you don't want to do fish sticks, you can do some crispy chicken tenders or something like that.
Absolutely, and not only that, but you could bake it then as well. So you don't even have to fry it if you don't want to.
Okay, talk to me about baking, Laura, because I really, really try to cut down on anything deep fried.
Okay, well, so with baking, the only thing you'll want to do most likely is spray it with a little bit of olive oil or a little vegetable oil or something.
Okay.
Just so it helps you get the color. Once you put it on the tray before you put it into the oven. Because if you don't, it's the panko won't brown up as nicely, and then the kids are going to see that. It's not going to look like what they're used to seeing.
Right. Okay? So you're saying after I coat it with the panko, put it on the pan, and then spray it with a little olive oil?
And then you're good to go. See that color? That's coming from the oil. So
that looks so nice and
golden.
See
how fast these are to cook?
That was fast.
So
now, when you put it in the oven, if you were to bake it, how long would it bake for and under what, how many degrees?
Okay, well, if it's fish that you're cooking, it just depends on the thickness of the fish, okay? Mm-hmm. So something that's about this size is probably going to bake in about, you know, within 10 minutes. If you're doing chicken, it's going to take longer, obviously, because you want your chicken to cook all the way through. So in that case, you're looking at probably closer to about 18 minutes.
Okay.
I say about 18 minutes, but I kind of do mean 18 minutes.
Sure, sure.
So.
Okay, that is good to know. Okay. All right, so I'm going to finish up this.
Okay.
And then why don't you start on our tartar sauce?
Okay, great.
I love that you've kind of blended the adobo sauce with it, too. I would not have thought of that.
I got to tell you, adobo is one of my favorite ingredients, the chipotle and adobo. So basically, it's a great tartar sauce. It's just a few components. Mayonnaise, as you know. Mm-hmm. Some dill pickle that's been chopped up. So we'll just add that into here.
Right.
And then some sweet onion. And I like using sweet onion because it's as flavorful as every other onion, but it doesn't leave the gift that keeps on giving.
Oh, yeah.
You know, on your breath. Now, as far as the chipotle goes, though, this is actually a jalapeno that's been dried and smoked and then steeped in an adobo sauce, which you can buy in a can at the grocery store.
Mm-hmm.
And when I do that, what I do is I bring it home, I open it, and I will puree that.
Mm-hmm.
And then sometimes I'll even go ahead and get the seeds out.
I'm sorry about that.
That's okay, because you're in gummy land.
You know what? I did commit the gummy. I broke the law. Wet hand, dry hand, wet hand, dry hand. Okay.
That's because I've been distracting you.
I know. That's okay. And I'm trying to concentrate.
You know, just throw me under the bus. It's okay. So.
You're so cute. Thank you.
So now, here's the thing, though. So this is a jalapeno. Hot. Okay. It's been dried. You got to love a culture that changes the name of a pepper once they've dried it. Okay.
Right.
But if you're feeding this to kids, they may not like the spice factor.
Okay.
So if that's the case, either eliminate it completely or at this point, mix this up and then take some of it out and then have plain for the kids and then mix the rest with some of the chipotle. Or, you know what? Don't even use it at all, or add some smoked paprika or something like that, or pull some ranch dressing.
Yeah,
exactly.
That'd be easy.
Yeah, and who doesn't like ranch when they're putting a fish stick or a chicken finger or something into that? So I'm gonna add a little bit of the chipotle to this, and then the only other ingredient is some lemon juice, because that acidity is gonna spark everything, and you can't exactly have something with fish without lemon, right?
And when you're squeezing the lemon, this next part is specifically for our planner, Cassie, because she has committed another sinful act when it comes to using this. This is my favorite tool when it comes to squeezing
the
lemon juice.
This is a great tool.
But she was doing, and you said a lot of people actually don't do it the correct way.
Yeah, so I teach classes, and I always point out that you do not want to be intuitive with the lemon juicer, okay? Do not, you know, follow the shape, because if you do, you're going to end up squirting yourself in the eye, and while I may find that comical as your instructor, I don't think you'll appreciate that.
Right.
So this needs to go face down so that when you squeeze the lemon, it
the
actually
comes out
the holes in the bottom. Right, exactly.
Yeah.
And you're just going to do that to taste. So you just want to add as much as you need. And then, of course, the most important thing you could possibly do once you finish your tartar sauce is taste it, make sure you like it, and then adjust it. If you need more mayonnaise, add that. If you want some salt or whatever, add that.
Wonderful. Well, gummy hands. I can't help it, Laura.
I'm sorry. We'll have to practice,
gosh. Okay, well, if you ever wanted to know how to make healthy sweet potato fries, we are going to do that right after the break. Don't have gummy fingers. Stay with us.